Welcome back. It's the Q&A show. I'm Jason Avant, another week with Inside the Birds, and my main man, Q, Quintin Mikell, are back again to talk about Eagles football, NFL news, draft, so many other things. Q, you want to talk to the fans today?
Let's do it, man. There was a lot to talk about, Crazy stuff going on right now.
Man, we were talking last week about how we were talking last week about a lot of things, and before you know it, bam, 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 bam. And that sixth pick that went to number 12 now, and a canceled game in Washington, and a lot of good players that are sacrificed because of it. And we're going to talk about all of that in a minute. But we want to shout out to Inside the Birds. We want to shout out to Jeff and Adam and everyone that's responsible for putting on this production. And all the fans that are tuning in, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. We appreciate all the support. We appreciate you commenting on our pages. We appreciate you guys going to the Inside the Birds platform on YouTube. We also are on Amazon Music now. We're doing a lot of great things, and we can't do that without you guys. So thank you guys so very much. And Q, you want to add something to that?
No, man, you said it all, man. Thank you so much. Everything's been great. We've been getting a lot of great response and a lot of great questions, and everyone's loving the show, and hopefully, you know, the more you love it, the more we can bring it to you and continue to just dive into this wonderful sport and this wonderful team we love, man.
Awesome. Now we're going to dive into it. I want to say a few things before we dive into it. Every Wednesday at 6 a.m., that's when the show drops. The Q&A show every Wednesday at 6 a.m. The Q&A show drops on YouTube, Inside the Birds channel and platform. So make sure you check us out. Q, there's a bunch of news this week. A bunch of news this week. We had the sixth pick, and we thought that we were in the running to get Ja'Marr Chase, who is an outstanding receiver who tore up the college football ranks a couple years ago. We thought we would have a chance at Kyle Pitts Kyle Pitts. Who am I thinking about right now?
Ja'Marr Chase.
And I'm kind of confused. I want your take on it. What do you think? Do you think we won this trade? Because we did stockpile another pick this year. We stockpiled a first round pick next year, in addition to the picks that we already have, and a potentially first round pick, second round pick, depending on what Carson does in Indianapolis. So do you think that we made the right decision with moving back six picks? And how does that look when the Eagles clearly tanked the game and would have been picking 10 to 12 anyway? So how does that look, and how does the fans take this? I've seen what the fans commented. They want to throw Howie off the side of a building. But let's see what you got to say about it.
Yeah. So, you know, that being said, you know, first of all, obviously the whole tanking situation and, you know, people losing their jobs for it, that's really unfortunate. And, you know, it's one of them situations where you feel for the guys. That's one of the things that you learn about this game in the NFL. It's a dirty business. And stuff like that happens. Stuff like that happens all the time. Yeah. And so it sucks, but that's part of the game. So now let's get back to the trade. So on Friday, when I saw it, I was like, man, what? Like, I was kicking the air, punching the air. Like, what's going on, right? Yeah. So, like, I started to analyze and look at it. And once you really look at it, if you look at the point system for draft picks and all that, the Eagles actually won on this trade to move down. And me and my buddy Tim, we were just kind of talking and going over it, and he actually did the calculations on it. And technically, we won on the trade by getting the picks and moving down. The craziest part about all of it is, and I don't know how to feel about this because I wanted to be so angry, but the craziest thing about it is we could have moved down and still been, we still have a chance to get the player that we want or one of the top offensive threats at the number 12 position, which I think is mind blowingly crazy. And that's all because of what happened with the Niners move up to 3 to take a quarterback. So now we've seen that there's going to be a run on quarterbacks, and there are people talking that it could go 1, 2, 3, 4 possibly five, the first five picks all being quarterbacks, right? That's crazy, right? And if that happens, it's going to be a landslide. Like, it's, I don't even know what to think no more, man. It's crazy.
It happens every year for some reason. I don't understand it. We get so enamored with the quarterback and we just throw all football philosophy and logic out of the window, right? We just say, this guy is great. And think about it. How many guys are great? How many guys come out of college and are prepared to play quarterback in the National Football League? If they were that great, why do you think Brady can play till he's 43 and Roethlisberger is still in the league and Drew Brees is just retiring now and Phillip Rivers just retiring now, Eli just retiring last? Like, this is why the guys aren't not leaving the league, is because we are missing on these picks. So you keep jumping in the first round, first two, three, four picks to get these guys that are going to be out of the league in 5 years, or on somebody's backup, or somebody's backup. And it just doesn't make sense when you have surefire players in front of you. And the teams that are not so enamored by these quarterbacks usually make out with good players that are in their system for 7 to 10 years. And that's a win. And I understand. You're saying, okay, if I hit on this quarterback, my franchise is set up for so long. But why not wait till you got something sure? Why not wait until that moment? When you got a chance to give away 3 or 4 first-round picks, I'll give it away for Deshaun Watson. I'll give it away for Russell Wilson. I'll give it away from a known commodity than something that's just pretty. So that's neither here nor there. I'm going to get off my high horse. I'm going to get off of it because it irritates me every year, because we act like the guy, like for Trey Lance, for an example, the guy's played 18 games as a starter. Like, you can't tell me anything. And then I sit back and I watch his tape. The dude is low in shoulders on linebackers and safeties. I've seen this movie before. This movie is called Injury. That's what that movie is called. It's called Injury. It's called Fast Injury Training Room. It happens repeatedly over a span of your career and you're never available. Yeah, it looks great right now. Oh, he's physical. He can run between the tackles. I don't want my quarterback doing that. I want to drop back, five, plant, and throw, make sure I'm hitting the curl, make sure I'm hitting the post, make sure I'm doing the right things. I don't need to see another running back that's playing quarterback. We got too many, and that's why the guys will never exit the NFL, because we're not developing these guys. So I'm going to get off that horse, Q. But get back to the main point. What do I think about the trade? Q. I don't know. I understand in how the metric says that the Eagles won the trade, because to pick up a third round pick, to have to have another first round pick of the Dolphins next year, to have your first round pick this year, to have the potential Colts first round pick next year. So the Eagles have they've stockpiled some picks, right? And with our draft success in the first couple rounds, we need all the picks we can get. So I understand that. That's just showing that, okay, I don't trust that I am going to be able to pick the right player. So let me get as many picks as I can. So even if one doesn't pan out, the other one may pan out, right? Yeah, but you can pick the right player in the top six, because you're guaranteed somebody, especially with the 49ers moving up, you guarantee the picks. You're guaranteed a Jamar Chase, who are surefire players that are going to succeed in the National Football League. Surtain, you may be able to get them that late, you may, but it all depends on if you want to chance it or not. I understand the logic behind it, and if I was the Eagles and I've had the success that I've had drafting players, I may have went for the pick more picks too, because it's hard to mess up 3-4 picks. Yeah. It's real easy to mess up one, and we've been known to mess up one. And a lot of people saying, you know, Jalen Waddle and all those things. Jalen Waddle is a really good player, really good player, but he's not fine-tuned. He's an athlete. He's this. He's that. You need somebody that's guaranteed when you're picking that high. And so I'll get on that another time, another subject.
So if you're sitting in at that position, right, and you're at six, and you have a feeling, maybe it could be a gut feeling, could be some of your research, and I'm not defending Howie and all at all, but knowing how many holes we have on this team, right?
Yeah.
Safe, if you're able, whatever you want, a whole entire new team, right? So if you're able to move down and get more draft capital,
Yeah.
And still be able to get one of your top three threats offensively, because that's a serious. I mean, we're talking run on quarterbacks. You got Dallas was not going to draft a quarterback. You got Giants not going to draft a quarterback. You got Denver may draft a quarterback, but they have holes everywhere. Detroit's got holes everywhere. So there's a chance that a player that you like, whether it's Pitts, Devontae, Chase, I don't think Chase gets past Detroit, but if he does, then
you win.
Anything can happen. You know what I mean? So, you know, you could maybe package something, move back up a couple picks. So I get it. I understand where you're coming from. Like, you don't necessarily have to overthink it. If you're at six and you stay at six, there's nothing wrong with taking Pitts or Chase right there. But at the same time, with so many holes, it might not be a bad idea to take the chance to get more capital and seeing if you can still get one of your top players there.
And I agree with you. And Q, I agree with you. I'm kind of frustrated a little bit. The reason I'm frustrated a little bit, because I feel like, I don't know. I just think that when you're a six, it's sure. When you're at 12, you need someone to have some type of misfortune or somebody to get taken that wasn't supposed to be taken. And the chances are looking that way because the 49ers moving up. So I understand what you're saying. So I get it. It's plausible to me. How the players that are available at 12, all right, let's talk through those, right? So you got a Quiddipay out of Michigan, who's out of position at defensive end. Yeah. You have a guy like J.C. Horn, who's one of the top three corners out of South Carolina. You got Caleb Farley, who just got a diagnosis of a medical.
He just had back surgery, right?
Yeah, and had to have back surgery, right? So he could fall down, and that right there puts me on Sidney Jones alert, right? So you just never know. That puts me on Sidney Jones alert. And then you have Patrick Surtain, who could be there. Then you got Devontae Smith, who a lot of people are thinking that may fall down in the draft just because of his size, right? And then you got guys like Jalen Waddle. You have, you know, I doubt if Rashawn Slater out of Northwestern, a big tackle, or Penei Sewell falls down that low, those guys are going to be, I believe, in that top five range. They're going to be going about it. So, but then you got, you know, the Jalen Phillips out of Miami. You got a bunch of guys that could possibly be there at the 12th pick. Who do you think and who do you see the Eagles taking during that time?
Well, I think there's a chance that Devontae Smith could possibly fall there. Maybe Micah Parsons.
Yeah, Penn State. He blazed it too at the combine.
Yeah,
or at the Penn State Pro Day, he blazed it.
I could see Quiddy Page, but my gut feeling is it's either going to be Devontae Smith, Jalen Waddle possibly, or Caleb Farley.
Do you think they feel forced to draft the offensive guy every time in the first round when they get this opportunity? Like, I'm not saying every time, but it seems to me that the splash players and who the fans wouldn't know is going to be on offense. And do you ever think that plays into the psyche of the people that are making these picks? Because if you get an unknown guy on defense or somebody that's not as well known, if you're not in that top five players of people of known players, right? And do you think that it's on the psyche of the people that are picking? Okay, they know Devontae Smith, or they know, you know, Waddle, or they know Jamar Chase, they know Pitts, they know these guys that are flashy, but do they know the Gilmore, or do they know, you know, other guys that are available, right? So do you think that comes into the psyche? I don't think that they think about those things, but what do you think?
Yeah, you know, I don't think they really care, honestly, either way. You know, because if you look at what happened last year everyone was Justin Jefferson, you know, and then we get Jalen, which, you know, he's still a young player. He's still going to develop.
He's going to be good.
Not hating on him at all. Mm-hmm. But everyone was saying Justin Jefferson. And so I do think there's a little bit of an element of, you know, maybe we're outsmarting everybody, or maybe the numbers say this, the numbers say that. But what does the tape say? Like, that's where I kind of struggle with. Okay, you can look at the numbers and analytics. Mm-hmm. But sometimes you just got to put the tape on. right? Just put the tape on and study the tape. What do you see on tape? And so I think it's a little bit of both, but I do think that they rely, the decision makers rely heavily on the numbers and stuff like that.
Yeah. So I think that the Eagles march to their own drum.
Yes.
They have been. And you know why? Is because we know that Howie is Teflon Don, right? So he's going to get as many chances as, you know, as need be. So, and it's not just Howie that's picking the players, the whole organization that has a hand in these players.
Yes.
I think over the years and people looking back to the drafts and saying, okay, there hasn't been a drafted player in the last, you know, 5 or 6 years that have been, you know, 5 years that have made the Pro Bowl. Now people are more, they're scrutinizing, you know, Howie and the organization and the scouting department way more stringent. So I think, and then you have the DK Metcalf, and then you have Justin Jefferson and all of these guys that you could potentially have had, and the fans are screaming it at you. It hasn't been like they've been quiet in the room. They've been like, take Justin Jefferson. You know, he's in DK Metcalf. Like, because when DK Metcalf blazed the combine, the whole Philadelphia was on fire. We got a chance at this guy, and we should take him, right? Yeah. And when Justin Jefferson, you know, catching passes in the national championship, winning, you know, the national championship, you, man, take this guy. He's the only one available. CeeDee Lamb, you know, Jerry Jeudy, Ruggs, if he falls, the only one to take was him.
Yeah.
And the Eagles did not do that. So I think subconsciously that undertone in the mind of the decision maker is going to be the fans, because the fans in Philadelphia, as much as you love this game, you have the ability to affect change. And as those rumblings get higher and hotter and hotter and hotter, we heard reports last year of Mr. Lurie saying, you know, I'm embarrassed by what I'm seeing on the field. I am this or that.
And he never talks like that.
Now, never talks like that. And that's because of the coaching, right? But if he can be embarrassed of the coaching, you can be embarrassed of the drafting process. And therefore, if you're embarrassed because the fans are embarrassed, therefore the fans should be able to affect some of these picks. And I'm hoping we get to the point where the fans have more say in the picks. You know, you trust your pros, but I'm saying in this situation, when there's history of botched draft picks, there's history of it. So they should listen a little more carefully to the fans. That's my thought. That's my two cents. You know what I mean? I'm just sipping my lemonade, but I ain't saying that, right?
So let me ask you this question, because there's another element of what happened on Friday, all right? So there was reports that came out saying that the Eagles tried to move up to 3 to try to draft Zach Wilson, right? Now, when I first heard that, I was like, here we go. I'm not going to lie. I'm like, here we go. And like, what is your – How would you feel if you're in the locker room, if you're hearing these reports, if you're Jalen Hurts, how would you feel?
I think there's only one way to feel, right? Because you've seen it. You've seen the plan. You've seen the roadmap. You was just this guy last year.
Yeah.
You know, so I think it would be hypocritical and foolish on his part to come out and say anything and or say anything or make any posture. But listen, I'm here to compete. I know that this is an opportunity for me. I don't own it. I'm written a chair. And because I'm written a chair, bring in who you may, who you will, whom you must. I'm going to show you that I'm better than them. That mentality wins over the entire city, wins over the entire locker room, wins over the entire organization. And therefore, that's the approach that Jalen Hurts should have. That's the mindset that he should have. He shouldn't come in saying, okay, I'm the starter. No, I got to come in here and earn it. There's a lot of people that are saying, okay, Zach Wilson, Trey Lance, this. Okay, take them. And I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you that I'm better now. And I'm going to make you look stupid. That's the guy I want playing quarterback, man. So with that being said, I pray that Jalen Hurts is not somewhere in his Carson Wentz mode, you know, worrying about who's being drafted, worrying about all of that stuff. I really don't think. Now, on the other hand, the Eagles have every – right to do their due diligence on every player.
Yes.
It's their job. you go out and you scout and you say, okay, this guy is better than our guy. And if that guy's better, you draft that player. That's their job. And so I don't understand why. I don't know. Job security in this country is very, very hard to get. Whether you're a plumber, whether you are a lawyer, whether you're an NFL player, it does not matter. It's hard to get. And if they can find somebody better than you, they're going to replace you with somebody. And if it's the same for you and I, it should be the same for the quarterback. Forget this mamby-pamby, softy, you know, type of stuff. That's my thoughts on the Q.
Yeah.
No, what do you think about it?
No, I agree 100%. And I do think that he's going to have that mindset. I mean, let's you feel for the guy because he's dealt with this at every stop that he's been at, you know, but it's not new to him. So I think he's definitely the kind of person that's going to say, all right, like you said, I'm going to prove you wrong. Like, bring it on. Like, this is the way I want it. So I do agree 100%. And I just think that it's just really confusing because, you know, we heard reports and of course the draft, there's always draft fog and you know, fake comments here and there just to kind of confuse people and keep people off your scent of what you're really wanting to do. Mm-hmm. So I it could have been a little bit of that where they're saying, hey, we're going to build around Jalen, but then let's try to, you know, get this move before anybody realizes Zach Wilson is that dude or something. So yeah, I think there's a little bit of that play here. But either way, all in all, man, I just want that young man to, you know, earn his spot and then show everybody what he can do.
Yeah, so I agree. And on the other hand, Q, on the other hand, there was also rumblings, right, of Deshaun Watson. Now, Deshaun Watson is in a world of trouble. I do believe that he's going to be able to overcome this trouble because a lot of it is he say, she say, and there's not much evidence. It's still going to be a smearing campaign of his reputation, and he's going to have to do a lot to restore his image. But with that being said, that aside, right, we're going to take the personal jar and we're going to put it over here. We're going to talk about the professional jar and what he's good at. He's a very good quarterback in this league. He is a top seven, you know, top five to some quarterback in this league. And you have the Dolphins' first round pick. You have your first round pick. You got a potential pick with the Colts. You got a lot of ammo over these next couple of years in order to make a move like that happen. And Q, would you make that move happen if you had the opportunity to get Deshaun Watson, even though you got a young budding Jalen Hurts in your stall? I kind of know what I would do. What do you think?
Yeah. So now separating the legal stuff, let's just assume that the legal stuff he's dealing with is not in the picture. Right. Mm-hmm. None of that ever happened. Right. So if I'm talking just strictly Deshaun Watson, the player before all this stuff happened, absolutely. Absolutely 100%. The guy is phenomenal. Can make every throw, can extend the play, intelligent, smart winner. Mm-hmm. So when you have a player, and he's still young, when you have a player at that level that's able to still play for a very long time, still, you know, lead your team for a very long time. I mean, the stuff he did last year with basically nobody. Was just phenomenal. So
yeah.
I do think if he's available, again, with all that stuff not being real or ever happening, I think you make that choice. Now, if we bring all that stuff into it, I don't know if I could make that call.
All right, go ahead, expound.
Only because,
okay,
you don't know. First of all, let's say we bring that stuff into it, right? You don't really know what's going to happen. You don't know if he's going to be suspended for an entire year. You don't know half a year. Like, we don't know what's going on. We don't know what's true, what's not true. So just the fact of not knowing, and I'm not even talking about his reputation stuff. I'm just talking about strictly, like, if I'm the decision maker, if I don't know how long I'm going to have my star player that I just traded all this capital for, I don't know if I can make that trade. And that's the way I'm looking at it.
I understand what you're saying, and I process what you're saying. And it's a very risky move. But to me, it's not as risky as most would think. Because if his reputation is smeared, quote unquote, around the league, and the charges are something of, you know, the he say, she say nature, if that comes out where, you know, there's video of him doing crazy stuff and breaking the law and different things, that's a whole different subject. But if it's a situation where it's minor offenses, I may take the chance. And I know a lot of people may be mad at me for saying this, but to me, it's like buying a house that a crime happened in a great neighborhood, right? As a real estate investor, yeah, there was a murder or something that happened in this house, right? And a lot of people is going to steer away from, but I'm a real estate investor. And that real estate investor is going to look at the house and say, the houses, the median income and the houses that are around this, the median for this house in this neighborhood is $500,000. This house, because that murder happened in it, is $200,000. Well, I'm going to buy that house because it's low market right now, and I'm going to put my renovations into it and make it valuable again, right? And I believe a team is in that position. I'm not saying that you're going to get Deshaun Watson for dirt low, but I'm saying is you're going to get him for a lower number than what you would normally pay in a good market because of some of the stuff that he has going on. And that may sound terrible to some, and I apologize to you, but what I am saying is there's an opportunity for some people that have, you know, a big enough heart and does enough research to try to see if you can rectify this man's behavior. And we don't know how well that is, because remember, in this country, you're supposed to be innocent until proven guilty. The man has not had a trial. We don't know the extent of what's going on. So let's be fair and honest to him. We do not know. But if it comes out that he can be salvageable, I'm making the trade faster than heaven gets the news, Q. It's happening. So that's my take on it.
So, okay. So let's continue with that, right? So we as teammates were in a similar situation with Michael Vick when he came, right? When he came to us from, you know, out of prison with the stuff with the pit bulls, right? Yeah. So very, very, very similar situation in terms of public, I don't want to say smearing, not smearing, but like just his reputation was just was destroyed, right? At that point. Like, I mean, there's people that just absolutely couldn't stand the fact that he was out of prison, and, you know, you can argue rightfully so or whatever. But so to me, the reason why it worked when he came to us is we had a strong locker room. We had a head coach that had been in place for many years. We had people that surrounded him, people that supported him.
Yeah.
If you bring Deshaun into a situation where you have a rookie head coach, you got rookie defensive coordinator, rookie offensive coordinator, you know, rebuilding, like, I don't know if this is a stable enough situation to be able to overcome something like that. So, you know, looking at this particular situation, I don't know if it's the right thing, but, you know, hopefully something good, you know, not good, but some, hopefully in the future, whatever happens, that he's not too far damaged. But, you know, if he did what he did, or what, you know, I don't know, man.
Yeah, you just hope it isn't that case. And just to piggyback on what you said about Michael Vick, man, the frenzy that was around Michael Vick and the level of hate, you would think the man murdered 55 people. Just with, you know, just in broad daylight in front of their families, execution style. That's the type of vitriol and type of hate that the man was receiving. So I remember that like it was yesterday, and how many people were outside of our NovaCare complex with signs, and how we had to, he might need an extra security and all those things, man. And I was like, man, the dog, man, is way different from the cat, you know, or the birds that they're fighting down in the South is way different from, you know, any other thing, you know. So for him not to even be the one that's doing it, right?
It
was crazy. Like, when you do the research of it, it's like, okay, that was the, you know, yes, it was at his home and those things, but he wasn't the one that was the kingpin of it. It was something that his people that were around him was into. But anyhow, that's neither here nor there. Let's transition to something else, Q. We're going to transition to the Joe Flacco trade, right? So we got a backup quarterback, or what we assume to be a backup quarterback in Joe Flacco. Joe Flacco is right from this area. He's from Audubon, New Jersey. For most people that don't know where that is, that's right over the bridge from Philadelphia. You actually can throw a rock from Audubon to NovaCare Complex. It's really, really close. And a local kid that has some success, is a Super Bowl winner. He's had some down years being with the Jets. You always have a down year if you go to play with the New York Jets. Everybody, you can't avoid it. It's very unlikely that you're going to survive that with a great reputation.
That's where careers go to die, right?
Yeah. You go to the Jets, you might as well say no. All right, peace out. I'll see y'all later. You know what I mean? That's it. It's over.
It's a wrap.
It's a fat lady right there waiting on you. And so he was there, and also with the Broncos, which he didn't play well. And he has a really, really big arm. We know him to be, you know, just a gunslinger. And he had some time where he was a really, really good player in this league. He's taken a step back. And what do you think about this trade with the Eagles?
I think he's just there to, you know, add some depth, add some, you know, some a veteran presence in the locker room, a veteran presence in the quarterback room, a guy that can step in if need to and manage a few games. I don't hate the signing. I don't hate that he's on the Eagles. I just, you know, at this point in his career, how much can he offer? So I do think he's a guy that can definitely step in. You know, let's say our starting quarter, let's say Jalen's starting quarterback, he goes down, you know, God forbid he goes down for a couple weeks. I think that Joe can step in and carry the team. I think that he can execute well. He's got a big arm, like you said. He knows where to throw the ball. He knows how to read coverage. He knows what he's doing out there. So he's just a veteran guy that can step in and kind of help when need be.
Where's the point, Q, where you realize in your mind that I'm going to be designated as a backup, right? Where is that point? Like, I don't know. It's time for me to retire. When it's time where I'm just like, man, I got to be, I'm not going to get in the game, you know? And look, I'm going to give you a funny story. I was in Carolina with Derek Anderson, and Derek Anderson was the guy that backed up. D.A., you was with D.A. too. I was with D.A. in Carolina, and D.A. did not want to go in the game. D.A., listen. D.A. would sit in practice and throw dimes. Like,
yes.
Money. Out of the break. Right there, I'm like, man, D.A. can spin that thing. The game starts, boy, D.A. getting fast, getting rid of that ball faster than you can blink. Well, you take two steps in the route, the ball already out. I'm like, man, what is going on? Like, the first read is right there. Like, he like, nope, check down. You're taking too long. I ain't taking it. That's just how it is. And he was just designated as a backup who did not want the game. And when you would call him up into the game, he'd be like, damn. Right? That's just how D.A. was, right?
So that dude was funny, man.
D.A. is hilarious. A great golfer, but he's hilarious. And what point do you think that Flacco is, like, accepting this new role as, you know, the backup? Now, you get paid handsomely for a backup in the National Football League. You still get $10 million.
Yeah,
for
backup quarterback.
$10 million for a backup quarterback. You just sitting there, you're encouraging, hey, man, good job. Throw, you know, whatever. Just don't throw too many steps because I don't want to go in.
Yeah, that's it. You're holding the clipboard. You signaling plays in. You're like, you know, but what the value to me, I've always thought the value to the backup quarterback is in – a lot of people may not know, football fans, but the backup quarterback is really who breaks down a lot of film for the starting quarterback. Mm-hmm. The backup quarterback will sit in meetings and with the quarterback coach, but a lot of times the backup quarterback is the one that's actually breaking down the reads, breaking down the coverages that they're going to see, and making sure that the starting quarterback is on point. So I'm okay having a veteran guy as long as he's willing to do that. Now, we may not know if he's decided that he is the backup quarterback. And quite frankly, I want him to want to compete for the starting job.
Yeah.
Right? Like, that's what you want. You want competitions all across the board. I think in my mind, looking at the signing, it looks like he's just coming in as a backup presence. But if I'm him, I would love, as a fan, I would love for him to be coming in like, listen, I don't care if right now, Hurts ain't starting. I'm going to start right now. So we got some competition at the position.
Well, that would be something to see, and I don't mind that at all. Mm-hmm. I'm definitely looking forward to seeing how Jalen responds with a guy like Flacco in the room, because it can be intimidating for a young player, because this guy is going to know where the ball is supposed to be, what yes. trajectory it needs to be thrown at, how hard it needs to be thrown. He's going to know those little intricacies that you don't know as a young player. And you have to be able to feel that pressure in order to go take your game to another level. I'm hoping that Flacco has some swag and has some type of charisma to be able to communicate with Jalen, right? Because I just hope that their personalities match. On the outside, their personalities to me does not match. If I'm looking at it, right? I'm saying these two people, in order to get along in the room, their personalities are so different. And I don't know Flacco, right? That's just me taking it from 1,000 feet. A guy like McCown, on the other hand, I would see him and Jalen being great in the locker room together, just because, you know, McCown has a different type of swag and has a different type of, you know, openness and approachableness that comes across. I don't necessarily know if Flacco has that same type of energy. We'll see how that plays out, and I'm looking forward to that.
I wanted to get on a different topic real quick, though, because we're talking about the draft, and you know, I had a conversation with Steve Scanlon, the head coach at the high school, Clearview mm-hmm. High School.
Yeah,
and he had a question, and I never really thought about it, so I thought it'd be great for us to kind of talk about it, right? So he wanted to know what our perspective pre-draft experiences were like. Okay. So like for you, like I didn't go to the combine or anything like that. You went to the combine. So tell me a little bit about your pre-draft experience. Like, what was it like for you?
Oh, okay. So during that time, right, I'm coming out of Michigan. I know that I'm not fast, right? I know that I don't run fast. I've never run a 40 or track or anything like that, right? So I know that I'm not fast. So my pre-draft experience is very, very nervous, because I know that I have the requisite skills on tape. I know that I'm a good player. I know that I'm better than every person that they think is better than me. That's the way I thought about it, right? When it came to technique and route running and catching, I knew that you couldn't run a better route than me, and I knew you couldn't catch the ball better than me, no matter how you stack it. But I knew there was a bunch of guys that can run faster than me. So my pre-draft experience was very, very hectic, because you can imagine I'm very, very competitive. So I want to run a 4.5 or 4.440 best I can in order to prove people that I'm not a 4.640. So I was trying, and it was hectic, and I kept seeing the time 4.61, 4.62, 4.59 when it was 100 degrees outside, right? But other than that, I wasn't getting it. If it was 100, I can get it. I can get there, but I couldn't get there consistently. So it was very, very stressful for me, because the only thing they care about as a receiver is how fast you run. Most of the guys, you can drop, I would say, a good 10% of your passes. Mm-hmm. As long as you can catch the deep ball, they're going to draft you high. That's just how it is. You can drop most of your passes. And as long as you run fast, you got opportunity. But when you don't run fast, they look at you like you are, like you damaged goods. Like, oh, this man. you should have heard so much. So for me, it was stressful, because I knew I had to get the time. And I knew I wasn't, God didn't bless me with that particular deal. So my draft experience for that reason was very, very tough for me, because mentally it was the first time that I realized that I'm going to fail at something. And I knew I wasn't a 4.4 and I wanted to be a 4.4. And so for my pre-draft experience is very, very stressful.
Yeah. Okay. So you got invited to the combine, right?
Yeah, so I got invited to the combine. So you know what's so funny is because Belichick, I had a meeting with the Patriots and I had to draw stuff on a deal. He's like, man, you know, we have you in here. And he said, you know, and the guy's like, every time, you know, because we're looking at Steve Breston, mm-hmm. you know, because he runs fast. And he's like, but every time we turn on the tape, number 8 keep popping up. And after a while, I told my guys, like, you're looking at, you know, another guy, but this dude keeps popping up. Like, so, and, you know, looking at Braylon, this dude keeps popping up. So let's give him an opportunity and chance. So I thought they were going to draft me. And that process for me, going to the combine, it was a meat market, right? So you go in the first day, you get down into your underwear, you walk into a room, an auditorium full of people with clipboards in their hand, and mm-hmm. that's writing down information. and you in there in your spandex shorts, and that's it. And they file you in line. You go in there, the dude is squishing your head down. He giving you a score, 6004, right? So I'm 6'1" and you know, you have the guy getting your weight, and it's a very, very structured. They go in, they probe at your body in the same hour as medical. They ask you how flexible your wrists are, ask you so many questions about injury. They get everything that they need to know when it comes to your medical. It's a very, 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 very humbling experience, right? So, but at the same time, it's fun because you get if you love football and you love like breaking down plays and talking to people. So that part was fun to me. The part leading up, I knew I would do good at short shuttle. I knew I would do good at three cone. I knew that I would do good in the L drill and all the other drills, broad jump, vertical jump, everything. But and then meeting the guys was fun too. Meeting all the other guys was fun. And you just see everybody's energy. You see the guys that are me guys that don't want to speak to nobody, that feel like they're better than other people. and then you meet some funny dudes. You meet some funny cats. Like, cause it's everybody from, you know, around the country.
Yeah, yeah.
And you just meet some dudes that just crack jokes all day. So it's like a big team for that particular time. Some people are standoffish into themselves, and then you got a group of players that are used to being around team, and they crack you up the entire time. Like, they talk about people. It's like, look at him. He over there acting like he better than everybody else. Boy, fumbled the ball 52 times last year. Like, you got them dudes like that. It's just funny.
That's awesome.
So tell me, like, were you disappointed? What was your experience? Because you didn't get a chance to go to the combine.
Yeah. Right?
And during that time, were you like, these people are crazy? What were you thinking?
Yeah, so my experience was a lot different. And then I got another question for you afterwards. But my experience was a bunch different. Now, we're talking 2002. So the game has changed a whole bunch since I came into the league. And so I didn't get invited. I thought I did. I thought I did well enough. I was a two-time defensive player of the year in the conference. I had a pretty good career, right? So I'm thinking I'll get invited, and I never got it. So a little frustrated, but so I did have pro day. So I had a pro day at Boise State. I can't remember. It was in March. Still cold in Boise. We're outside, still cold. And I didn't run well. So I think I was like right around same speed, 4.6, somewhere around there. And so I was lucky enough to be able to have another pro day. So I had my pro day in Boise. And I remember the main guy working me out was from the Ravens. And I never been so tired in my life, because I was the only DB that was coming out that year. And so he was having me do drills, bad pill, run this. And I was done. So I had nothing left in the tank. So I didn't show well. And I do feel like it wasn't my best showing.
You think he did that on purpose?
Well, that's the idea. Like, for people that know, that's a lot of times that's the idea when you get a private workout, is to see how hard and how far the potential draft guy or undrafted guy is willing to go, or how in shape they are, or you know, if I stress him out, will he crack? Right. So that was the way I took it, because it was a really abnormal type of workout. It was like beyond, above and beyond what I'd ever done. And also, when we're talking, this is a NFL, I was training at Boise State. I didn't get to go train anywhere else. So I was, you know, it was just a different, I don't think I was as prepared as I should have been, but that's, you know, neither here nor there. So I was lucky. I went to high school in Eugene, Oregon, and that's where U of O is. And so I made some phone calls. I forget how I got in, but they were having a pro day at University of Oregon at their indoor facility. And so, you know, I went home and I went and worked out at that the Oregon pro day. And I actually did much better at the Oregon pro day. I ran much faster. I measured better. I had a better workout, and it was better. But I do think that the damage was already done, because when I was working out at Boise State, that was like my moment where I actually had eyes on me, you know what I mean? Like, they were there to stay. There were other guys that they were looking at, but they were there to see me and how I was doing. So I do think that pro day was probably a main reason why I didn't get a chance to get drafted. So you know, but neither here nor there. Then after that, so I didn't get to go to the combine. So what we did back then, and I'm not sure if they still do it, but whenever there's a guy that's a potential free agent, instead of, you know, having them come to the combine, they'll bring you in for visits. So I visited San Diego, visited Chicago, and I forget, there was one other team I visited, the Dolphins, Miami Dolphins. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's kind of like the combine for you at these visits. So you go in a room, they measure you, they poke and prod you, they x-ray you, they check all your stuff out. You have a meeting with the head coach, you know, you have dinner with all the other guys they brought in, and then they send you home the next day. So very similar, but very different, you know, path to the pre-draft path to the NFL.
Yeah. No, you say you had another question for me. How, what was it?
Oh yeah. So we always hear these reports of like the crazy questions and like the weird stuff that players get asked at the combine. Do you remember any weird questions or questions that kind of put you in the state of like, what the hell he just asked me?
I can't even remember. It's been so long ago, but I remember, I think it was it somebody from Kansas City? It wasn't in the room, but somebody asked me something really offensive, but I can't remember right off the top. And it may have been at the Senior Bowl. I think it was at the Senior Bowl. He asked me something about my mom, right? And was like, your mom's not out. Yeah, something about my mom. And like, was she like in a prostitution or something like that? It was along those lines. And then he said, I just want to see how you was going to respond to that question. I'm not trying to offend you or whatever it was, but the guy just wanted to just see if I was like, but I want to see, he didn't say prostitution, he said hoe or something like that. And I looked at him like this. He's like, man, chill out. He's like, I just want to see how you was going to respond, you know, whatever it was. But it was somebody from Kansas City. I can't remember exactly the situation, but it was in my hotel room, oddly. But I do remember that part of it. But most of the time it was just football stuff. So that was an anomaly. And I think that wasn't at the combine. I think that was a Senior Bowl. Okay. But it was just football stuff, right? They'll ask you to break down like your best play, like, mm-hmm. and ask you stuff that doesn't pertain to you to see if you know it, right? So they'll ask you what the lineman does on this and what's the protection of the play. You got post corners and you got a basic in the middle. What's the protection? Mm-hmm. Right. They'll ask you stuff above and beyond to see how much you've been paying attention. Right. And if you can break down those things and or you can know like coverages and or they'll ask you, you know, hey, what beats this coverage? And if you can break down and say, OK, this player got hook curl. This person runs the middle. This person has the flats. This person does this. And here's the rules. If it's 3-by-1, the safety is looking at this. You know, like, so if you can break that down, you do really well. And that's why guys that have that football acumen will do well in those interviews, and you can kind of draft them based on those interviews, but that has nothing to do with how well they play on the football field. Because I know a bunch of players that cannot break down X's and O's, but you get them out there on the football field and magic started to happen. So you got to make sure that you get a football player and not a philosopher.
Yeah, you're right. Because I've been in a unique position to be in the building for a while. So when Chip Kelly was he was head coach, I was able to kind of be like an intern kind of shadow with the coaching staff a little bit, Corey Unlin and those guys. And I remember when Eric Rowe came in for his pre-draft visits, and I'd been sitting in a bunch of different meetings, but Eric Rowe blew everyone away. I mean, X's and O's, like he was on point with everything. He knew everything. Like he could tell you what coverage is, what, you know, where he should be. Like he was just really good with the chalkboard. He was really good with breaking down tape, and he was really impressive. Just his football knowledge of the game. And it's a shame, because he actually, after he left, I think he got traded, right? Did he get traded
he got traded to
New England.
Yeah.
And then I think he's still in Miami, or at least last time I checked, he was down in Miami.
I haven't kept tabs on him.
So he's, you know, long story short, he's ended up having a pretty, pretty long career, but it didn't work out here. But, you know, he was a phenomenal guy. So it was really cool when you were telling me about that. It was bringing back memories of watching Eric do that during that draft process.
Yeah. So all of those things that they ask you during those, what were you doing for the draft? Like, when the draft was going on, were you sitting there watching it with family? What was going on?
I'm gonna tell you about my draft day. So, so the first, you know, I didn't think I was gonna go first day, so I wasn't really tripping on it. But I was watching. I remember it was Polamalu was the safety that came out. Eric Doss from Ohio State.
Yeah.
I think Chris Crocker.
Yeah.
There's quite a few safeties that played a while. So second day comes and I'm like, okay, I'm thinking, you know, I don't think I'm gonna go, you know, early. So we get to the sixth round. I'm like, okay, now I'm getting mad. Like nothing. Get to the seventh round. I'm really not gonna get a chance, right? So I'll never forget. I go outside. And this is when I was in Eugene, Oregon. I went home and I went outside and I couldn't think about nothing else. I was so angry. And I was just shooting hoops, just shooting on my basket. And my dad came out. My dad was like, hey. And I'm like, what's up? And he's like, how you feeling? And I said, and I'll never forget this. I said, I'm pissed off. And he said, well, when you get a chance, you show everybody why you pissed off and that you're pissed off. And I said, I will. And like, that was it. Like that moment right there, shooting in the middle of the street, just thinking about how angry I was. Like, that's where it all started for me. It was like, I'm about to show everybody. Like,
nice.
This is it. And so, you know, so then the draft, so a lot of people may not know. So during the seventh round, like towards the end of the draft is when the coaches start making the calls to potential free agents to try to get them to get you to sign with them. So I had the Buffalo Bills and I think the Bears and then the Eagles, and Sean McDermott had called me the week before, and he called me, hey, I'm Sean McDermott. I want to see if we can get a chance. We're looking at you. We have a free agent seventh round grade on you. If we can try to get you, we'll get you. So then he calls me right after the draft, and he called me during the seventh round, and he's like, you know, trying to get me to sign with the Eagles as a free agent. And I said, hey, coach, with all due respect, I'm trying to get drafted because there were still guys' names coming off the board. And he's like, well, if you don't get a chance, if you don't get drafted, just consider us, you know. So I'm like, all right, whatever. So the draft doesn't go. Then my agent, who was – I had my agent at the time, was Michael Hoffman out of Beverly Hills. He called me and he said, hey, listen, there's the Buffalo Bills want to bring you in, Chicago, and then the Eagles. And he's like, the Eagles are probably the best chance for you to make the team because they had just drafted Mike Lewis. They had Dawkins. They had just drafted Mike Lewis the year before. They drafted Norman Lejeune, the same draft as mine. And then that was it. There was nobody. So I had an opportunity to make the top four, and that was the best chance. And so I was like, I told my agent, like, I don't really care where I go. I know wherever I go, I'm staying there. So, you know, I flew out the next day. I signed with the Eagles, flew out, and then the rest was history, man.
Wow. Wow. The underdog story. That's what I like, right? You get mad out there shooting hoops. Dad come out like, you know, I'm pissed off. I'm going to show somebody how they messed up. That's an awesome story, man.
Yeah.
And a lot of people don't understand like the process after the draft and if you're drafted or not. So that's a great story. Great one. I wanted to transition into something else. Cause we can talk about it just for a brief moment. And then we're going to cut this one. Cause we talked about everything that was set to be talked about, during that time. Now, a lot of people wanted to know what receivers, DBs, like what makes them, you know, a little bit different when they're coming out of the draft, like what makes a receiver stay in the league? What makes a receiver good or not? And I'm going to give you guys just a few points, a few tips. It's not the player that's just running for random touchdowns in the game that's going to transition well to the NFL. The guy that you can just throw a gadget screen to and he makes everybody miss and everybody think that's going to happen. The chances of that happening in the NFL is very few and far in between because guys are so great with angles. They're so great with technique. They understand and where they need to channel the ball to. It's just a more disciplined, more professionally run league than college is. Therefore, it's professional. So guys for running for long touchdowns, just think about how many of those in NFL you see per year. You just don't see as many as you see in college football. You see one every week on pretty much every team where a guy's taking something 50 or 60 yards. You have to be in a position to usually a guy in NFL is not missing that tackle in order to let a guy. And even if he misses it, he's going to miss it the right way to give you an opportunity to catch him 5 to 10 yards down the field, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what makes a receiver is not the explosive play. That's a part of it, but it comes down to route technique. If a guy has the subtlety and body movement, i.e. a Stephon Diggs, i.e. a Devontae Parker, i.e. a Justin Jefferson, those guys, what's the kid in Keenan Allen, right? Those guys that no one really knows about in college, they're sitting there working their craft. And when you can see them, because they jump out on tape, because they're using technique to get open and not just running in open air. There's a lot of guys that just run 4-3, 4-4. The coach telling them to run an over route. They run fast as they can. And the guy that's chasing them is a 4-6 and they can't catch up to him. The guy in the NFL, even though he runs a 4-6, he's going to be in the best technique possible, and he's not going to let you get over there unencumbered, right? He's going to touch you. So you need to know more than just what you see on the paper. You have to be able to make the paper dance, right? So if I have a 10-yard in route, I can stem it up in, come back out, do it. As long as I'm in the quarterback's timing, I can make that in route look like 5 or 6 different routes. And that's what makes a receiver good, is being able to use your expression and make people think that you're doing something that you're not on the quarterback's time, right? You can't just take and be shaking and baking and taking all day. You have to be able to beat these people with your feet, with subtlety, with strength, something that's powerful within a few steps, right? A few steps. And those guys that are route technicians and that have good hands usually stay around the league. Yeah. It just happens. I don't know what it is. You see guys every year. You see guys like, what's the kid out of Florida that was Percy Harvin? Percy Harvin was a really good NFL player, but Percy Harvin was the man in college. Ted Ginn was the man in college. DeAnthony Thomas was the man in college. Yeah. You can go on and on and on down the line. Peter Ward was the man in college. All of these guys that was these explosive players, everyone's so like flabbergasted and astonished by these particular players because they're so amazing. Reggie Bush was the man in college, right? Yeah. But those guys that understand the technique of running routes, playing the game, all of these things, I'm not saying these guys won't have success, but it's going to take them longer to learn the nuances of route running when you're just a pure athlete. And that's where you get into the guys like Jalen and Jeremy Maclin, who developed into a really good route runner, but was very, very raw. Jalen Riggs, very, very raw. Jalen Waddle, very, very raw. And now you start to get to the guys like Devontae Smith, who were 170 pounds, but he knows route technique.
Yes.
And a guy that knows route technique is dangerous. So don't sleep on a guy like that. Because if he can take a punch, or they may not even touch him because his feet so well, right? His feet so good. So when you get a guy that can shake you at the line, that can dip, that can do stuff like that, that's going to make the best NFL player. And I am not the guy that's going to look at the tape and be wowed by a guy catching a bunch of deep balls. Because I know, guess what? The least completed pass in NFL is a fade or go ball.
Yep. For real.
Everybody throws it. You only catch it 4% of the time.
those aren't the routes that kill you. It's the routes. Like, I always think about the good route runners like Torrey Holt and Isaac Bruce back in the Greatest Show on Turf days, right?
Yeah.
A lot of in-breaking routes. And the thing that was crazy, they'll run a 15-yard dig like it's nothing, catch it, and then just fall on the ground. You can't even get a hit on them, right?
Yeah, so that's irritating.
So, you know, it's not the guy. You know, it's not the guy like you're saying that's going to run the fade routes all the time. There are some, you know, you got Megatron, a guy like that. You got, you know, Deshaun. But although I do think Deshaun runs great routes. I think for me personally, a guy like Deshaun was always tough because his stride stayed the same. Whether he was running a go route, an in route, a slant, his stride always stayed the same. So he was very tough to read when he ran his routes. But, yeah, I mean, I agree with you 100% there.
And to me, that's what makes an NFL receiver, a player that everyone knows in college is not the guy all the time. Yeah. And I tell you the truth, the same is true with DB technique. Like you can, the same is true. The guy with great technique in college, the guy that has a knack for the ball. That's the two things that, like, if you have good feet, good technique, and you got an eye for the ball, you're going to be, like, and that's it. Like, you can avoid, you can hide stuff when you're a great technician.
Right.
Like, I can make up for my lack of speed because I'm a great technician.
Yeah.
I can make up for tight hips as a DB because I have great technique at the line. Absolutely. You ever notice that guys that have terrible hip movement be great at the line of scrimmage? That's the only way they can survive.
Yeah.
Because if you start to get them running, you're like, man, if I turn this hip, it's over. But you can't ever get them in that position because they're like, I know my hips are bad. So therefore, my line of scrimmage game is off the charts.
Yeah. Gotta be. It's gotta be. That's gonna be a wrap.
It's gonna be a wrap. Like, and those guys, you look at, man, listen, if I can get a clean release, it's over. That's how it was when 90 first got here, and we realized, okay, if you're gonna release verse 90 and you just run a little bit, he can't slow down the way that everybody else can slow down. And I love 90, great person, you know what I mean? But we understood that at the beginning. It's like, okay, he has this really big stance. He would try to get as big as possible in the stance, but you can't really move far. Like, so if a guy's trying to dance with him, he gonna shoot him and hit him in the chest. But if you just take that cheat release I tell everybody not to do on him, it works. And that's the mindset of being an NFL player. You're never supposed to take a wide inside or outside release because you're giving up all your yards. But again, certain players like 90 or a bigger body like that, it's okay because all you want to do is get him running, because once he runs, he can't change and stop with you. You know what I mean? That's just the way we thought about it.
That's crazy. And it's, you know, that's the thing that's crazy too. When you go back and watch tape, like if I'm 90, right, and every time I step up to the plate and I'm going against you and you're doing the same type of release on me, I should adjust my technique a little bit, right? Yeah. I should understand, listen, okay, I know what he's going to do. I line up right and press. He's just going to try to press me hard inside or outside.
Yeah.
So let me get ready. Let me take a baby step. Let me take a couple of baby steps back, right? Back at an angle, because I know which way he's going to go. He's either going to go this way or that way. He's either going to go wide left or wide right on me, right? So I'm just... So what do you think it is where some players aren't able to study the tape and then adjust that?
Is it that comes to deal with like football IQ. Mm. It has nothing to do with book smarts. It has nothing to do with, you know, how well a guy does on a Wunderlich test or IQ test. Has to do with just natural football IQ. Some guys just have it. You don't have to teach certain guys angles. Like, as a coach, you spend half your time teaching young dudes which angle to take in order to make the tackle. Like, listen, if you run around a block that close to the blocker and that close to the ball, you're gonna run past the ball. The ball is gonna get beyond you, you know? Yeah. But the guys that have that naturally, it's the same thing. Some guys have it and some guys doesn't. Some guys don't. Some guys have it, some guys don't. And it's like, for us, it's physics and geometry. That's what football is to me when it comes to blocking and tackling. It's physics and geometry. You're looking at this guy and you're doing a mathematical equation in your brain. And a lot of people don't recognize it as that. You're saying that dude is running that fast, at that speed. His intersection point is right there. So instead of going this way, I'm going that way to intersect him at that point. That's all it is. And it's the same way on offense, defense. If you want to be a good blocker, you got to know intersection points. And and some guys have that naturally and some guys just do not. I don't know what it is.
That's crazy. That's 100% too, man. Like, you see it all the time. And usually, like we were alluding to earlier, right? The guys that get it are the ones that stay around longer, right? The guys that understand the little nuances of the game, the guys that understand the angles, the guys that understand, you know, hey, maybe if I do it this way, even though the coach didn't teach me that, or even though the coach said I should do it this way, I'm going to do it this way because this is what's working for me. So all of that stuff is, you know, that's all part of what helps a player develop and what helps a player stay in the league long. And that's why, and this is also alluding to what we're talking about in past shows, is that when you have a same coach in place for a while, you're able to develop those little things. Yeah. Right. A player has the confidence after year two, three with the same coach to
try new things and develop new things. And when you're overturning, when you're turning over your position coaches every year, or, you know, firing coaches every 2-3 years, you never really get to develop a player. And that's what everyone's there for, right? They play the game. So
you're preaching right now. You're preaching because it's hard to please 3 and 4 coaches. It's hard to, because this coach has in his mind, this is the way it needs to be done. This is the way it needs to be done. And there's nobody that'll get you out of the league faster than a coach. I'm telling you, I'm telling you this right now. A coach will get you out of the league by doing a technique, outdated technique that does not work, because Jerry Rice did it that way. This is the way you need to do it. Yeah, Jerry Rice was playing against dude whose shoulder pads are bigger than their body too, right? Right, I'm looking at his tape. Why the dude sticking them wearing number 77? Like, what are we talking about? Yeah, I'm not taking anything away from him. I'm just telling you the truth. The technique is outdated, and if you keep teaching people like that in 2021, you're gonna get jammed like that, because the technique is different. It's just like anything else. Like, yes, VCRs are expired, MP3, whatever it may be, are expired. Like, you just don't go to CDs anymore. You got an MP3 player, right? Like, you just don't do it. So, and it's the same way with technique. You got these coaches that are teaching us outdated stuff, and they so bullheaded, they're in a position to coach these guys, but their stuff is old. It's been in the refrigerator too long. You got mold on it. Like, no, you got to get some updated information, right? So, and you as a player, you understand what the heartbeat of the game is because you're in it. You're seeing guys come up with new moves. And then the coach say, oh, you want to be like Devontae Adams? No, I want to be like the dude that's getting open. Because the dude that's getting open is helping the team. The dude that's getting open is going to Pro Bowl. And the dude that's getting open is making money. And you sitting over there talking that stupid stuff, right? And that's just how it is, right? So
that's real.
So a coach would get you out of this league or get you out of NFL fast and listen to his dumb stuff. Brett Favre said it the best. Most of the time, you got to overcome your coaches too.
That's it right there. Overcome bad coaching.
Kim, man, that's going to wrap up our show for this week. We try our best to get done in an hour. We stay going over, man. We try our best to get done in the hour. That's going to wrap it up. Do you have anything else you want to talk about?
I'm good for today, man.
We're good for today. We talked it out.
So we could touch on some more stuff like next week, man. So this is always fun, man. I enjoy it as always. And love talking to you, man.
Always. And everybody that's paying attention and everyone that's tuning into us again, we're on the Inside the Birds platform on YouTube, also Amazon Music, social media, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. Make sure that you're checking us out. Again, this is the Q&A show. We're appreciative of everything that everyone is doing when it comes to supporting us. Shout out to Jeff and Adam for having us. And we're going to take this show and make this one of the best podcasts in this country. And I look forward to it. To next week, talking to my man, Quintin Mikell. Sign us out. Q Mike.
Let's go, man. Hey, appreciate it. Love it as always, man. Listen. I'm having a great time doing this. I'm having a lot of fun. Fans, all the support's been great. Drop us your questions, whatever you want to know, whatever you want to ask us, let us know, man. Social media. Yeah, that's it, man. I'm not good at signing off, but let's go.
Q&A show. Peace.